welcome to this 59th Baccalaureate service for Hope Sound Bible College and Hope Sound Christian Academy. We are so glad you're here. This is a very special occasion, as you already know. We'll ask you to remain standing as our director of music comes to lead us in a congregational song, and then please remain standing for prayer, if you will.
Please join me as we sing hymn number 641, Lead On, O King Eternal.
Lead on, O King Eternal.
We always choose a member, the parent of a member of our graduating classes for the invocation and benediction. And this year we have the happy privilege of having two gentlemen that have two children graduating. And the first of those is Pastor Orpha Maravell, and he has two fine sons graduating, one from college and one from high school. And so it is our pleasure tonight to ask Reverend Maravell to come and lead us in the invocation.
Thank you, Dr. Stedler. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of celebration. It is also a time of worship, and it's a time of thanksgiving. For all these years, Father, you've been with our high school and college students through it all until they make it this far. You've sheltered them under your wings. You've protected them against all the snares of the enemy, Father, so they can make it this far. And by your help, by your grace, we know they're going to make it beyond our expectations, and all the glory will be yours. So we're here today to praise you for them, but also praise you with them for all that you've done, Father. We ask that your mighty hand will continue to be upon them. We ask for your blessings over them all the days of their lives, dear Father. I plead the blood of Jesus over each one of them. I plead the blood for protection. In this world that we live in, Father, oh, how much we need your protection and your help and your guidance. So I plead your help, your blood over these kids, oh, Father. Be with them. I also plead your blood over them so there'll be nothing between you and them. That way you can have all the power, all the access that you need, Father, in their lives to direct them, to continue to cause them to live for you and by your might. And finally, I plead the blood of Jesus over them so that no weapon that forms against them shall prosper. So today, we ask that you be with us in every segment of this service. So everything we do and everything we do, through it all, Father, your name will be exalted. We thank you and give you praise and glory ahead of time in the precious mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Oh, What a beautiful, beautiful song by the chapel choir. Thank you so much. And may that be the prayer of all of our hearts. But having been here at Hope Sound for just a little over 5 years, it's been my privilege to be able to say I've been able to watch this student body, at least a lot of them, in the college department from their freshman year through, and then seeing many of the ones come into the high school and graduate. And it is a beautiful thing, it's a wonderful thing to see so many of you saying, Lord, that is my prayer. Shape me, mold me, use me, fill me, and I'm submitting my life to you. And I promise you, if you'll just continue to make that your prayer, God will continue to help you and walk with you. And it is just a privilege of ours representing Hope Sound Bible Church just to say thank you for your attendance here at this church. Thank you for your participation here. Thank you for the way that you've stepped in to help in so many, many different ways. And it has truly been an honor and a privilege to be able to be part of your lives in these last few years, and for some of you in the days to come. We do want to give you just a couple of announcements, and that is simply this. They're very simple, and that is the 8th grade graduation will be tomorrow evening right here in the CEC at 7 o'clock. If you're interested in being part of that, you be here at that time. I'm not, but my son is graduating, so therefore I will be here at 7 o'clock. Kindergarten graduation is Friday at 10:15. If you are interested in being part of that, 10:15 right here in the CEC Friday morning. And then Friday evening is the moment that so many of these have been waiting for, and that is commencement, when they're able to turn their tassels and say wahoo very quietly. But nonetheless, it is coming. It is coming. It's exciting. And be here at 7 o'clock to celebrate their wonderful milestone that they have reached. So thank you, graduates, for your participation in our church. It truly has been an honor and a privilege to be part of your lives.
I had to chuckle as he was talking about his son graduating from the 8th grade. When I came to Florida, my wife informed me within the first year that we were going to add to our family, and I told her she was crazy. She wasn't. She's sitting right back there. I'm not my wife, the product of that information. And that same year, Mr. John Jones and his wife found out they were expecting a girl who became my daughter's, one of her very best friends. So we're waiting eagerly to see what happens with, no, we aren't. I look for opportunities to get at Pastor Matt because he manages to get all the rest of us, you know. It is, as you know, a momentous time at Hope Sound because we are in the process of a transition. I think everybody knows that. And the board has selected our speaker for tonight, Reverend Matthew Maloyed, as the 4th president of Hope Sound Bible College and Hope Sound Christian Academy. And I am so thankful that God has helped us to have a wonderfully smooth transition. I think that's very, very important for the long-term health of an organization. And I just tonight want to publicly say how much I appreciate this young man and his family and their willingness to commit to this responsibility. And tonight I would simply say to you, all of us have a vested interest in him being successful in this role. And my challenge to you is, let's pray together for him that God will be his guide and his protector and his sufficiency, and I know that God will. President Maloyed graduated in 2008 from Pennview Bible College, a college in Pennsylvania that started just shortly after Hope Sound Bible College did. As a matter of fact, Dr. S.D. Heron was a man of such magnanimous spirit that he went up to join with them for the beginning of that institution, and he came back to Florida and told Pennsylvania students they're starting a new school, and I would encourage you to consider it. If God wants you to go there, you feel free to go. Some did, some did not. Reverend Harry Plank is here tonight. He and his wife were from Pennsylvania. They chose to stay and became graduates of Hope Sound Bible College, and we're very proud of how God has used them across the years. But it's interesting that our speaker tonight comes from that institution. I had the privilege of being at Penns Creek Camp as one of the evangelists when they celebrated the 50th anniversary of that school. And Brother Heron was there when they started, and I got to be there in the 50th anniversary celebration. So that was very special. So he graduated in 2008 from Pennview Bible College. And then he went on to pastor and be a part of the pastoral team at Beavertown God's Missionary Church. And was there for 14 years. And in the process of that, he became the head of the Central Pennsylvania Youth Convention, which is one of the largest, if not the largest, convention of its kind that is held within our movement. And he was a tremendous blessing. And of course, it is a tremendous blessing that he was working with young people. Little did he know that maybe we'll be coming to Hope Sound and be a part of our effort here. He also was president of the God's Missionary Youth Camp, and then he served as the director of the youth division of IH Convention and did that for 10 years. And then God called him to bring his family and come here. And we are so thankful that God has done that. And I'm confident, as I said earlier, that God's directions always involve God's enablement, God's power, God's sufficiency. Dr. Churchill and I have worked together now for 27 years, and we chuckle often about sitting right over there on that front bench. And I said, Cliff, do you remember? You had just gotten your doctor's degree, and I asked you to be academic dean, and I didn't even know what I was asking you to do. And his response was, well, I wasn't sure what I was supposed to do either. But it was one of the best things that ever happened to either one of us. We're very different people, but I could not have found another person to work with that has complemented my weaknesses with his strengths. And I simply say that same God is still alive and well. That same God is right where he always was. And that same God has spoken his support for Hope Sound Bible College. He has provided for us, he has sustained us, and now he's given us a leader going forward. And so it's my happy joy tonight to present to you Reverend Matthew Maloyed.
Thank you, President Stettler, for that lengthy introduction. It's almost as long as what I have to share here tonight. President Stettler, Academic Dean Churchill, Principal Booth, the Hobe Sound Christian Academy graduates, the Hobe Sound Bible College graduates, and family of the graduates and friends, it's my distinct privilege to be given the opportunity to speak in this baccalaureate service. Some time ago, I heard a motto that has never left me. In fact, it comes to my mind quite frequently. This little motto has become one of my favorites, and because of it, it just really describes in a lot of ways the goal and the purpose of life. The motto goes like this. I know it's one that you've heard before likely, but it goes like this. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. And for the next few moments, I would like to take a look at three simple truths that we find by dissecting this motto and then make some just practical applications to our lives. First of all, it begins with the phrase, only one life. And this tells us that our life is single. The first modern missionary from America, Adoniram Judson, said this, you have but one life in which to prepare for eternity. Had you four or five, two or three of them might be wasted in carelessness, but you have only one, Every action of that one life gives coloring to your eternity. How important then that you spend that life so as to please the Savior. And those are profound words. This life that you have is the only one that you will ever have, so you must make it count for eternity. You must live your life for the things that count. You must spend your time investing in God's kingdom. There have been many people who at the end of life, they've reflected over their time here on earth and they found that they had so many wasted years. Years where they neglected their family for a job. Years where they had not been there for their children when they should have been. Years that they squandered on living for self instead of serving God or other. Years that they lived for sin, pleasure, popularity, making money and accumulating material things. And many, no doubt, wipe away tears of regret and wish inside that somehow they could live their life over again. But unfortunately, they can't, and we can't, because our lives are single. You only have one life to live, and then it's over. So you better make it count, because your life is single. The motto goes on to say, It goes on to say this, it says, only one life, 'twill soon be past. And this reminds us that our life is short. The Bible has several fascinating metaphors telling us about life. And listen to what the Bible compares our lives to. And as you do, you will notice that the central theme of these comparisons is the idea of the brevity of our lives here on this earth. First, our lives are compared to a vapor. In James chapter 4, verse 14, it says, for what is your life? It's even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. Our lives are compared to grass and flowers that wither after a short time in the sun. In Psalm 103, verses 15 and 16, it says, as for man, his days are as grass, as a flower of the field, so he flourisheth, for the wind passeth over it, and it's gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. Our lives are compared to a shadow. In Job chapter 14, we find these words, man that is born of a woman is of a few days. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not. Our lives are compared to a story in Psalm 90, verse 9. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. And our lives are compared to a wind that passes by. In Psalm 78, verse 39, for he remembereth that they were but flesh, a wind that passeth away and cometh not again. And aside from these terrific mind pictures that we find in the Bible, comparing our lives to a vapor and grass and flowers that wither after a short time, and a shadow, a story, a wind that passes by, we find one thing in common about all of these things, and that is that our lives are short. Our lives are short. The army that great King Xerxes led against Greece in 480 BC consisted of 1.7 million men besides an enormous fleet. And when Xerxes looked over his vast forces from a prominent place, the port below was covered with his ships, the plains were filled with his troops from different nations. He turned to his uncle, one of his commanders, and he told him he was happy. But after just a few short moments, King Xerxes began to weep. And asked by his uncle why he wept, surrounded as he was by so much glory, he replied that he wept to think that of the vast crowd arrayed before him, not one individual in it would be living in 100 years, including himself. And Xerxes not only had military genius, but some measure of wisdom as well, because in the light of eternity, the brief span of your life is but just a tiny speck in time. Graduates, no doubt you've had to memorize a timeline, maybe for a Bible class or a history class or something like that. And one of the remarkable things about timelines is how one line or how one dot on a timeline will represent a big event, or sometimes they even represent like the lifespan of an individual. And the amazing thing is that if you were to look at the lifespan of a person on the timeline of eternity, we would need a microscope, because life life is so short. Our life is single, only one life. Our life is short, it will soon be past. And the last part of the motto says, only what's done for Christ will last. And this reminds us that our life is serious. Yes, our life is serious. And yet many people have no idea why they're even here on this earth. Millions of people wander through life with no earthly idea why they are here. I find it interesting that the Bible often compares people to sheep. And if you've spent any time observing sheep, you can see why. Sheep, by their nature, they live only for the moment. Their line of vision is never more than just that next clump of grass. They just chew a clump and then they move on to the next clump. Slowly and gradually, they get further and further away from the fold. And without a shepherd, they would wander off with no direction or purpose. And there are so many people that are like that. They only live for the moment, the next clump of grass of pleasure, having no direction or purpose, not knowing what they're really here in this life for. God's word tells us what we're here for, though. The Bible tells us we were created for one paramount purpose from which every other purpose emanates, and that is to bring glory to God. In Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 7, we read, "Everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory." And why are we here? We're here to bring glory to God through our lives. And if this is true, then everything that we do ought to be done for the glory of God. No wonder Paul commands us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 31, "Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God." God has put us here on this earth to glorify Him, and we do that by loving Him with all of our hearts, fellowshipping with Him and serving Him. And we can only do that by trusting Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, making a complete surrender and consecrating ourselves to God, and then letting Him guide and rule our lives. And when we come down to the end of our short lives and we face eternity, the important thing will be what we've accomplished for the Lord and His kingdom through His Holy Spirit's power working in and through us. Someone wisely said, "Time is lent to us to be laid at God's service. It is precious, it's short, it's passing, uncertain, irrevocable when gone, and that for which we must be accountable. The clock of life is wound but once, and no man has the power to say just when those hands will stop, at late or early hour. Now is the only time we own to do His precious will. Do not wait until tomorrow, for the clock may then be still." Paul said in Philippians chapter 1 and verse 21, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." And let me ask you a question, graduates. Is that your testimony? Is that your testimony? Can you honestly say, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain"? If you're honest, perhaps it would be, "Well, for me to live is pleasure." Or, "For me to live is the American dream." Or, "For me to live is money or material things or popularity or man's acceptance." And if any of those statements are true in your life, then you cannot say, in all honesty, the last part of the verse that says, "And to die is gain." No, if any of those are true, then to die is loss in a sense. Why? Because to have lived will have been loss. And to die is to have to come to terms with a life that was misspent and wasted on lesser things. And graduates, I urge you tonight to live your life with such a commitment to God and His kingdom that you can honestly say in your heart of hearts, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." It was Max Lucado who wrote the short story entitled Temporary Castles. A little boy is on the beach, on his knees. He scoops and he packs the sand with plastic shovels into a bright red bucket. And then he upends the bucket on the surface and he lifts it. And to the delight of the little architect, a castle tower is created. All afternoon, he will work spooning out the moat, packing the walls. Bottle tops will be centuries. Popsicle sticks will be bridges. A sandcastle will be built. Big city, busy streets, rumbling traffic. A man in his office, at his desk, he shuffles papers into stacks and he delegates assignments. He cradles the phone on his shoulder and he punches the keyboard with his fingers. Numbers are juggled and contracts are signed, and much to the delight of the man, a profit is made. All his life he will work, formulating the plans, forecasting the future. Annuities will be centuries, capital gains will be bridges, an empire will be built. Two builders of two castles. They have much in common. They shape granules into granders. They see nothing and they make something. They are diligent and determined. And for both, the tide will rise and the end will come. Yet that is where the similarities cease. For the boy, he sees the end, while the man ignores it. Watch the boy as the dusk approaches, as the waves near. The wise child jumps to his feet and he begins to clap. There is no sorrow, no fear, no regret. He knew this would happen. He's not surprised. And when the great breaker crashes into his castle and his masterpiece is sucked out into the sea, he smiles. He smiles and he picks up his tools and he takes his father's hand and he goes home. The grown-up, however, is not so wise. As the wave of years collapses on his castle, he is terrified. He hovers over the sandy monument to protect it. He blocks the waves from the walls he has made, salt water soaked and shivering. He snarls at the incoming tide. It's my castle, he defies. The ocean need not respond. Both know to whom the sand really belongs. And I don't know much about sandcastles, but children do. If you watch them, you can learn. Go ahead and build, but build with a child's heart. When the sun sets and the tides take, applaud. Salute the process of life. Take your father's hand and go home. C.T. Studd, the great missionary to China, India, and Africa, he wrote the following two little lines I heard one day, traveling along life's busy way, bringing conviction to my heart, and from my mind would not depart. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one, soon with its fleeting hours be done, then in that day my Lord to meet and stand before his judgment seat. Only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, the still small voice gently pleads for a better choice, bidding me selfish aims to leave and to God's holy will to cleave. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, a few brief years, each with its burdens, hopes, and fears, each with its clays I must fulfill, living for self or in his will. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. And when this bright world would tempt me sore, when Satan would a victory score, when self would seek to have its way, then help me, Lord, with joy to say, only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Give me, Father, a purpose deep, in joy or sorrow, thy word to keep, faithful and true, whate'er the strife, pleasing thee in my daily life. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Oh, let my love with fervor burn, and from the world now let me turn, living for thee and thee alone, bringing thee pleasure on thy throne. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one. Now let me say, thy will be done. And when at last I'll hear the call, I know I'll say 'twas worth it all. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. And when I am dying, how happy I'll be if the lamp of my life has been burned out for thee. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. And so consider these truths tonight. Your life is single. You only have one life to live. Your life is short. It's only a tiny speck of time in the light of eternity. And your life is serious. At the end, it's heaven or hell. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. And if that's true, and it is, what are you going to do about it? Congratulations, 2022 graduating class. May God richly bless you as you live your lives for Him. Our prayers go with you.
Thank you, President Maloyed. That was excellent. I really, really enjoyed that. Now, our benediction tonight is a little bit unique. I will ask the high school choir to make their way to the platform, please. The reason for that is that we have a benediction prayer, but we also have a vocal benediction following that. So I'm going to ask you to stand at this time. I'm going to ask Reverend John Beardsley to come to the platform. He too has two children graduating tonight. His son is graduating with an Associate of Arts degree, and his daughter's graduating with a Bachelor of Arts in Education. John himself is not a very distant past graduate. He came to Hope Sound a number of years ago and left. And in the period of time that intervened, God did some wonderful things and brought he and his wife, Janie, back. Janie served as cook for a number of years. John was a student first, then became dean of men, and then they left to go do what we all knew they were going to do sooner or later, pastor a church. So it's a joy to have you back. You have wonderful children. Come and pray the prayer of benediction.
Father, this evening we are reminded of how needy we are. Father, we are reminded of all of the many days that has been behind these graduates, the days that they have called out to you for help, all of the assignments that were due and the prayers that were made. And Lord, we're thankful today that we serve a God that listened. He heard those prayers. And Lord, you have helped each and every one of them to reach this milestone today. Father, as they go from here and as they step into the future that you have for them, I pray, God, that you would help them to always keep their eyes upon you. Lord, we know that life can often bring things that we don't expect. And Lord, as we have gone through this life and we have recognized the things that have taken place and the times that you've stretched us and the times that you have taught us, I pray, God, that you would help each one of these graduates to never forget that, Lord, the only way that they can truly be successful in this life is if they keep their hand in yours. So go with them, Father, we pray. Encourage them, help them,
Open the doors, Lord, that you'd have for them, and close the ones that would lead them in the wrong direction. And Lord, as you help them, we will continue to praise you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for coming. We look forward to seeing you Friday night, and you are dismissed. There will be no recession tonight.